Hi friends, welcome to this session by Med Miracle. When we look at the exams and the patterns changing, things have clubbed together, four exams into one. FMG was cluttered with lots of images and clinical scenarios. NEET will change to next, but two things will rule: the clinical based questions and images. Images, when I speak, includes short videos or GIF. So I thought, let's have a session about how to approach image-based questions. So a dynamic name came to my mind, Dr. Anand. He can take you on a ride, tell you the importance. Images-based questions can be simple image answer. Question, even if without image, can have an answer. Image can be an add-on there, but when you have to combine the image with the question and arrive at an answer, there requires a skill. As we go down, more and more practical things will start coming in the exam to select a candidate who has really worked during MBBS. I hope this session opens up your eyes how to approach image-based questions, how to prepare image-based question in your exam. Have a great session with Dr. Anand. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So hello, everyone. Welcome to Pediatrics by Dr. Anand. So this, in the picture, in the video, you can see our beautiful Med Miracle app. In this app, we have various sections. We have subject-wise, we have physio, anatomy, all the subjects which you need. We also have the image-based questions, image-based pearl of the day, spotter of the day, which will be very useful for you for your day-to-day practice. Because as you know, image plays a very important role for clearing the exam. Everything has started changing into clinical-based questions, image-based questions, video-based questions to be a better doctor. So we have this Med Miracle app, which has all these subject-wise test series, image banks, question banks, all the important things which you need basically to clear your exams. So now I'm going to start the session, which basically have all the important points I'm going to cover, how you can do the image-based thing. So I'm sharing the screen now. Yes, so we shall start now. So I'm just enlarging the screen. Yeah. Thank you so much. So now we're going to start the important session where we can understand how to decide which images are important in pediatrics. How to decide which images are important in pediatrics. So that is the first question comes to every student. They ask me, sir, should I cover the textbook images or should I cover the MCQ book images? Which images, sir, please tell me which are important for me for the exams. So always remember that the textbook images plays a very important role, because the textbook images have all the recent stuff, all the important stuff which you should know. So first question is, the MCQ book images are better or the textbook images are better? The first point is, you should be very thorough with the textbook of all the images there in the textbook. Okay, that is the first point. Now, second important point are the clinical postings. Like today's topic is like, what all images are important for me in pediatrics or in any subject actually. So most importantly, clinical postings, all the final year students who are attending this session, all the case presentations, all the everyday rounds, which you see, you go to every ward, see NICU, PICU. I hope you understand what is NICU and PICU. So most importantly, for the image base, your clinical posting plays a very important role. Okay. For example, like this case, if we talk about, you know, so what is this case? Like if I mute this thing, so this is a clinical posting. So the question is, what all images are important? It's a very important small short video, which you see in your day-to-day clinical postings in pediatrics. This is nothing but a Gover sign, seen in Duchenne muscular dystrophy. Again, this can be an image-based question. This can be a video-based question. This can be a small GIF. So most importantly, you need to know that clinical presentation, what all cases you see in your daily practice, those are very important, even for the third year MBBS students or the final year MBBS students. This is the case of Gower Stein, seen in Duchenne muscular dystrophy, which is a proximal muscular dystrophy. I hope you are able to understand. So I'll repeat again. Number one, textbook images are very important. You need to learn thorough with them, see them, understand them, the textbook images. Second most important, you need to know whatever cases you see in your day-to-day presentation, those cases are very important. Those only will come as a NEET PG, AIMS, whatever exam you say, so to make you a better doctor. Okay, now next important point. Again, every pediatrician or every final year MBBS student can never go without the milestone, because milestone is the bread and butter of pediatrics. So again, as you can see this picture, again, it could be an image-based question, it could be a video-based question. So most importantly, can anyone tell me which milestone are we talking about? So you know that this is nothing but sitting, very good. So it's nothing but sitting without support. So you know that one is sitting with support and one is sitting without support. So sitting with support comes at 6 months, and this one is nothing but sitting without support, which comes at 8 months. Okay, 8 months. So sitting without support comes at 8 months. That's another question. Step by step, slide by slide, whatever I'm telling you, those are actually important recent image-based and video-based questions which came in NEET and AIMS and PGI. So you better pay attention. So did you understand? Number one, textbook images are very important. Number two, whatever clinical cases you see day-to-day in your gynae rounds, in your ward rounds, bedside rounds, or pediatric rounds, those are important. This image was a recent question for the sitting with support and sitting without support milestone. This child is showing sitting without support. Like he's standing like this, yeah, sitting like this without using the hands down. So sitting without support comes at 8 months. Okay, we have covered three important questions also. Now coming to the next slide. Okay, so one more thing also you should know is this one. Yeah. So what all, again, the same question. Today's topic of choice is what all images are important is concerned. So this is a very basic, again, I'm telling you, clinical posting. So this is a very important picture showing you the color of the size of the IV cannulas. Again, a very basic question. So they're always asking exam that which size is this? So you know that, right? We have this blue is, you know that blue is 22. So we have yellow, which is 24. So these two are the recent question. See, again, I'm telling you, whatever cases you see, whatever spotters you see, like a nasogastric tube, like a suction tube, you know. So this session is all about what all images are important and how to fetch which image I should study for pediatrics, you know, that you should know, right? So most importantly, this one, so this slide, you know, this is nothing but the pediatric normal IV cannulas. And you know that blue color one is the 22 one, right? And 24 is nothing but the yellow one. I hope you're able to understand that. I hope my voice is clear to everyone. So again, that's important. So this was a recent question also regarding the blue color cannula, which is 22 number, and the yellow color cannula, which was 24 number. These recent questions in the AIMS paper, okay? That you should know. Okay, now next important point. Again, I'm repeating again, today's session is about what all images are generally important in pediatrics, plus how to choose which image is important. Like, how can I approach an image-based question? How can I approach to an MCQ which has an explanation also, which has an image also? So my answer to you right now is whatever images in general, in your rounds, in your case presentations, in day-to-day practice, in your medical college, those images are important. They can come for your exam. For example, this instrument. So can anyone tell me, very good? So this instrument, this is a very simple device, very good. So this is nothing but a phototherapy unit, right? This is nothing but a phototherapy unit. So you see this in day-to-day practice, in day-to-day case presentations, in general, you see, right? Very good, very good. We have wonderful people who are answering. Beautiful. So this is nothing but of how can exam come. Like in the exam, the recent questions regarding phototherapy was this question. This was a recent question. The question was, what should be the measuring light irradiance of the device unit shown? So I showed you a phototherapy, and the question is, what should be the measuring light irradiance of the device unit shown? So beautiful. So Shweta has a wonderful answer. Very good, Bhavna. Very good, Dr. SK. So yes, very right. Very good. So around 30 microwatt per centimeter square per nanometer is the measurement of the phototherapy unit. Are you understanding? That's what. Again, I'm telling you, for the final year MBBS students also, be around 50-60 students who are in final year MBBS. What all cases you see in general, like a nasogastric tube, like a phototherapy, like an IV cannula, like a suction catheter. So these all questions can come as an image-based spotter in the exam. I hope you are able to understand. I'll go to the next slide. So very important, short videos plays a very important role. You all have given recent aims also. So a lot of multiple questions, they are asking short video-based questions. Are you understanding? And for that, you have to be very vigilant in your postings. Your postings who are in third year, MBBS students, final year, interns, whatever casualty, those only can be portrayed as an image-based or a video-based question in your exam. Okay? I hope you are able to understand. And also, like this also. So can anyone tell me what is this instrument if I play this video? So can anyone tell me what is this instrument? So what is this? Anyone? What is this device showing in the picture? Any idea? What is this device? What do you call it? So very good. So this is nothing but a infantometer. Very right. Very good. So this is nothing but an infantometer. So this also can come as a video based, image based questions also. Like what is an infantometer? What is the height? So these all images can come. Okay. Very good. Very good. Okay, so just give me 1 second. I'll just try to, just 1 second. So these were the important questions which in general can come in your exam, like an infantometer, like a stadiometer, all the recent images in general, which you see in your day-to-day practice. Those images are very important for your exam. Okay, that you should know. Okay, then we have this infantometer, like that we can have stadiometer, which are the basic pediatric instruments, which can come as an image-based question and can also come as a video-based question. Okay, very good, very good. So coming to the next quarter. Yeah, so yes, so Dr. Mayank, yes, do BedMiracle app has image-based questions. As far as the pediatrics is concerned, it's purely my dedication in that. So all the videos, images, notes, pearls of pediatrics I have done. So you can go through anytime. Coming to the next question. Can anyone tell me what is this instrument? Can anyone help me out? What is this instrument called as? Again, a very basic, everyday round, a basic question. So what do you call it? Very good. So this is nothing but a, very good. It's nothing but a stadiometer. Very good, Dr. Sumitra. Very good, Dr. Madhumita. So this is nothing but a stadiometer. So what is the use of stadiometer? To take the height of the baby. So this in general you saw as an intern in pediatric department, and that only can come as a NEET PG or an AIMS research. So today in this class also we have covered around 5 questions. We saw infantometer, we saw stadiometer, we saw Duchenne muscular dystrophy, we saw the IV cannulas and their size, and we also saw the phototherapy. These were the top 5 recent questions which came in the exam. So are you able to, I hope you're able to understand. So we'll go to the next slide. Now, what is this instrument? So what do you call this instrument? Any idea? What is this? I don't remember. And can anyone help me out? What is this instrument? What do you call it? Which caliper it is? Very good. So Dr. Kaur, we have wonderful answer she has given. So it's nothing but a herpenden caliper. Very good. So nothing but a, Dr. Bhavna, very good. So it's nothing but a herpenden caliper to know the caloric reserve of the body, to know the body fat, a basic thing, right? Herpenden caliper for the skin fold thickness. Very good, Dr. Tina and Dr. Madhumita. Beautiful answer you're giving. So again, this is an image-based question, which you should know. Okay. Yeah. And one more, recently I wanted to share one information with you. There was a recent exam in Indore. There was a recent MD pediatrics medical exam in Indore. So what happened in that exam? There were 7 candidates. In that exam, there were 7 candidates and they were given a newborn examination. To examine a newborn, they were given 30 minutes. Examiner said, I will give you 30 minutes. You have to examine this newborn one by one. And whatever findings you are able to tell me, so that is enough. So you can tell me, right? So what happened after the exam, like what the result came, 6 failed and 1 passed. Out of these 7 candidates, 6 MD pediatrics candidates failed and only 1 passed. So the head of department got worried. He went to the examiner. He's like, sir, these all students are very dedicated and very hardworking, top ranker students. So what was the problem they could not clear? So the examiner, the external examiner said that all the 7 students, I told to examine a newborn and whatever findings, whatever abnormal, whatever findings you can tell me in this baby, you have told. Someone said low set ears, syndromic faces, whatever they could able to tell, they told. But the reality was, it was a normal baby. There was no abnormal finding in the baby. It was a normal baby. So only one candidate said that there is no problem with this baby. It is perfectly normal. Whereas the 6 candidates, they said all the findings, abnormality, they said whatever they were able to say. Okay, so now that comes to a very important conditions in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. Again, an image based question as well as, you know, recent question. What are the things in a newborn which looks abnormal but are normal? Okay, so very good, beautiful answer, Dr. Tina. This is something known as acrocyanosis. You might have heard. Acro means periphery. Cyanosis means bluish discoloration, right? So acrocyanosis also is condition in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. Have you heard of melia? It is a condition known as melia, where the keratin gets deposited beneath the, so it's a condition which looks abnormal but is normal. So now today's session is image based. What all images are important? How to proceed for images? So there only the first pediatric dermatological image which I want to tell you is very important. What is this picture? What do you call this? What is this? Can anyone tell me? What is this picture? Any idea? What are these rashes? Any idea? I don't know. Can anyone help me out? So what are these maculopapular pustular rashes? Yeah, very good. So Dr. Madhumita is very right. So these maculopapular pustular rashes with an erythematous base, with base that is known as erythema toxicum. Again, the today's session is what all images are important and how should I proceed, how to approach for an image based question. So my answer is, whatever daily day-to-day cases you see in general in your wards, in your ICUs, those are the first pictures and images which are should be targeted by you. And this picture is nothing but erythema toxicum, a condition in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. Next one, so this is same picture of the erythema toxicum, okay? These all are the erythema toxicum, okay? Erythema toxicum, the name is toxicum, but it is a benign condition. It is the accumulation of eosinophils. E for erythema, E for eosinophils, okay? Now, what is this? One more condition. What is this? This is neonatal pustular melanosis. It is a condition in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. So how do you differentiate? So can you see that? Very important. So this is nothing but, again, this is a maculopapular. Macule means change in the color. And what is a papule? Change in the color plus little elevation, right? So it is a maculopapular pustular lesion without an erythematous base, without an erythematous base. And point also, okay, very important. Okay, so without an erythematous base. Okay, very good, Dr. S.K., very good. Remember, erythema toxicum will be with an erythematous base, whereas neonatal pustular melanosis, this condition will be without an erythematous base. And it contains neutrophils. Okay. Again, image-based question, which is important and which you should know. Okay, what is this? This everyone knows. Even my niece also knows this answer. So can anyone tell me what are this demarcation points? What is this melanin here? So very good, very good. So nothing but Mongolian spot. Okay, so neat PG question number one. Which is the most common location of the Mongolian spot? Can anyone tell me? Is it the upper or the lumbar sacra? Which is the most common location of the Mongolian spot? So very good, Dr. Sanya. So lumbar sacral region. Very good, Dr. Madhumita. Very good, Dr. Suresh. So lumbar sacral. The most commonest location for a Mongolian spot is lumbar sacral region, and we have to link and study. And most commonest location of a meningomyelocele is also lumbar sacral region. Okay, I hope you're able to understand. Okay, so again, so what are we reading? Images. What are important? How to approach? Okay, so we saw erythematoxicum. We saw neonatal pustular melanosis. We saw Mongolian spot. Okay, now what is this? Can anyone tell me any idea? What are these small? Can we appreciate this small capillary hemangiomas? What do you call it? Any idea? What are these small? Can anyone tell me on what is this? What do you call it? Any idea? Very good, Dr. Maya. So this is nothing but stalk bite, or also known as nevus simplex. Okay, stalk bite or nevus simplex, or also known as salmon patch. Okay, very good, Dr. Shweta. Very good, K20. So nothing but small capillary hemangiomas. So known as stalk bite or a nevus simplex or salmon patch. Okay, again, an image based question. Condition in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. Okay, what is this? Any idea? Can anyone tell me? Dr. Maya, what do you think? What is this condition? What are these small white? Any idea? What is this hidden? Can anyone help me out? What do you call it? Yeah, very good, Dr. Shweta. Very good. This is nothing but melia. Okay, very good, Dr. Maya. Nothing but amelia, where the keratin gets deposited. Condition in the newborn, which looks abnormal but is normal. Conservative management is required. Nothing to do. Counsel the mother and that's it. Okay, again, we saw a wonderful image. Okay, this is nothing but melia. Now, what is this? So kindly mute your mic. What is this? What is there in this palate, soft palate? What do you call this condition? Very good, very good. So, Dr. iPad, we have iPad also. Yeah. So very good. Yeah. So kindly mute your mic. Thank you. So her name only is iPad. So what to do? So there's nothing but on this palate with epithelial pearls. Okay. So condition in newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. And epithelial pearls can also be seen over this condition also, over this preputial. Very important. Can you appreciate this? Preputial epithelial pearls can also be seen over the palate also and over the preputial also. Okay. Hi, Dr. Maya. It was you who was laughing. Okay. Dr. Maya is also a pediatrician in our pediatrics WhatsApp group. Okay. Perfect. So next. Okay. What is this condition? Let me see the next picture. Okay. So these were the conditions in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. One second. I'll just this. Yeah. One perfect. This one second. Yeah, this one. So what is this? What do you call this? Any idea? What is this condition? What is this? And can anyone help me out? This one. What do you call? What color change? Very good, Dr. Swati. So this is nothing but a Harlequin color change. Very good. So nothing but a Harlequin color change. Harlequin color change. Very good. Very good. So it's a demarcation. Can we see a demarcation? We have the reddish areas. So again, a condition in a newborn which looks abnormal but is normal. Harlequin color change. Harlequin color change. Okay, what is this picture? I'll give you a chocolate. Dr. Maya, can anyone tell me what is this picture? What do you call this condition and which gene is responsible? Yeah, very good, Dr. Bhavna. So it's a Harlequin ichthyosis. Okay, Harlequin ichthyosis. Very important. Can you see this wrinkled skin? Yes or no? This wrinkle. Can you see swelling of the eyes, right? Can you see the smitten fingers like a important Harlequin ichthyosis? Okay, Harlequin ichthyosis. Dr. Kaur, very good. This is not a normal condition. This is an abnormal condition. Some babies die in utero. Even some also have later a very difficult and painful life. So very good. ABCA12 gene mutation. Very good. We have amazing toppers over here. Beautiful answers people are giving. So very nice. This is the case of Harlequin ichthyosis. The gene responsible is ABCA12. It is a lipid membrane barrier defect where the treatment is IVD, IV, and vitamin A. Okay, yeah. Okay, Dr. Ayush, teeth in a newborn is also normal. in general, in some cases, it is a normal condition. Even one of my cousins, also, she was also having an HLT. But you should also rule out other conditions like Pierre-Robin syndrome, epidermolysis bullosa, Ellison-Creval syndrome, and Sotos syndrome, because those also have natal teeth. Next question. Yeah. Now, again, today's session, this only, how to approach a question and an image. A lot of students are asking me, sir, should I only read the question? Sir, should I only read the image? Sir, how should I do? Because I get confused. This is the most common question a student asks. How should I correlate question plus the image? Should I read only the question or only the image? So point number one, see some questions, now listen to me, question and an image. So one scenario I'm giving you, some questions, like they are the image-based diagnosis, like they're the spot-on diagnosis. Some questions, the images in the some questions are spot-on diagnosis. So what can you see in this picture, what radiograph showing you? Is nothing but the lateral radiograph showing you Dr. Mahima is very good. The acute epiglottitis, yes or no? So it is spot on diagnosis. I don't even have to read the question also. But the question also is telling me the patient will have all the 5 D's in epiglottitis. Remember, dysphagia, dysphonia, drooling, difficulty breathing, drooling of the saliva. The child will have a tripod position. He will sit in the front. His mouth will be open and he'll have a cherry red epiglottis and acute epiglottitis. So the first set of questions, it will be spot on diagnosis. Spot on. You see the image and tell, sir, this is the diagnosis. This is one set of questions. Are you able to understand? This is the one set of questions. Like for example, this one. Again, for this also, can anyone tell me what is the diagnosis? For this, I don't even want to know the question. I can just close my eyes and tell you. So Dr. Bhavna is very right. So nothing but croup, acute laryngotracheobronchitis, right? It's nothing but croup, right? This what sign is this? Any idea, Dr. Maya? Sign, steeple sign. Very good. Can you see this church steeple? Yes or no? So this only is the church steeple. So this only is the spasm which I can see over here. So this is nothing but the steeple sign, which is seen in croup, which is nothing but acute laryngotracheobronchitis. And that's very important. Okay. And remember, acute epiglottitis, which you see, you saw the thumb sign. This one is known as the thumb sign. If anyone doesn't know, this is known as thumb sign. That was steeple sign of the church steeple. And this is nothing but the thumb sign, like a thumb sign. It is in the lateral radiograph. Whereas croup is the normal PA view. Remember that. Okay. For acute epiglottitis, you give antibiotics. Whereas for the croup, you give dexamethasone and adrenaline nebulization. You give steroids in croup, whereas you don't give steroids in acute epiglottitis. You give third generation cephalosporins, nothing but ceftriaxone. Okay, I hope you're able to understand. So this set of questions, what I'm trying to say, some questions are like spot on diagnosis. Image, but it is like a spot on diagnosis, okay, that you should know. Okay, like this again, it's again a spot on diagnosis. This image has only one answer. This image does not have any other answer. So what do you call it, Dr. Maya? Okay, what do you call this? Which cephali it is? Any idea? Yeah, very good, Dr. Shweta. It is a holoprosin cephali. Holoprosin cephali. Okay, number one, it is a case of holoprosin cephali. Number two, it is a four-brain anomaly. Okay, it is a four-brain anomaly. Okay. So basically, most importantly, holoprosin cephali, it is a four-brain anomaly. Normally, our brain is divided into right cerebral hemisphere and the left cerebral hemisphere, right? So failure of the forebrain to divide into right and left cerebral hemisphere, failure of the forebrain to divide into right leads to a condition known as a four-brain anomaly, nothing but holoprosin cephali. And remember, there was a recent true and false question. Is it a neural tube defect? So no, the answer is no. Holoprosin cephali is not a neural tube defect. It is a four-brain anomaly. Neural tube defects are spina bifida, occulta, and apata, and meningocele, meningomyelocele, and cephali and all that. Okay, so again, what I'm trying to say, what is the topic all about today? Image-based. One scenario will come where the image is like a spot-on diagnosis that you should know. Okay, straight away spot on diagnosis. Can anyone help me out? Any idea? Dr. Maya, are you there? Anurag also should be there. I'll just send him one of my junior Anurag. He's from Jammu. Yeah, so Tina, trisomy 18. Okay, Madhumita. Okay, she's also. So before the can anyone tell me? Like, yeah, very good. So what is this? Is nothing but rocker bottom feed. Yes or no? Very good, very good. So it's nothing but rocker bottom feed. Yes or no? So number one, the mnemonic is Rocky M for the newcomers. R O C K Y M. Number one, it is trisomy 18. Okay, trisomy 18. Okay, we have trisomy 13, 18, and 21. This is trisomy 18, which is nothing but Edwards syndrome. Edwards syndrome. Yes or no? It is a case of Edwards syndrome. Trisomy 13 is anyone? What is trisomy 13? Trisomy 13 is Patau syndrome. And trisomy 21. Very good, Dr. Tanya, Dr. Tina. Very good. So we have trisomy 13, 18, and 21. Trisomy 13 is Patau. Trisomy 18 is Edwards syndrome, which is the picture. And trisomy 21 is Down syndrome. So this picture, the mnemonic is Rocky M. So R for rocker bottom feet. Okay, R for rocker bottom feet. Number one. Number two, O for overlapping digits. O for overlapping digits. Okay, that you should know. Can you see that? Over. E for cardiac defect. K for kidney defect. Okay. Y for microcephaly. Okay. If you can write Y for microcephaly. And M for mental retardation, which is now known as intellectual disability. Okay. So again, I'll repeat, image-based spot-on question. It is a case of Edwards syndrome. The mnemonic is Rocky M. R for rocker bottom feet. O for overlapping digits. P for cardiac defects. K for kidney defects. Y for microcephaly. And M for mental retardation, which is now known as intellectual disability. That finishes the mnemonic. That finishes a recent question. And again, basic pattern. Now, next image. So, now we are coming to the next lot of questions. One slot of question is that you have a question and an image, but some images are spot on diagnosis. Now, this is a second scenario question. Now, for this second scenario question, I agree the image is quite visible, but the question is something else. So, let's read the question. So, the question we have over here is a 6-month-old baby. So a 6-month-old baby with macrocephaly, dilated veins over the scalp, which is the best surgical management of this condition. So are you able to understand this question? It is the indirect question. So to answer this image, you have to read the question. So now this is the second set of questions where you have to read the question. The question will lead to one diagnosis and then the image will correlate with the diagnosis. So even my grandmother also can tell it is a case of hydrocephalus. And the question which they have asked is, what is the best surgical management surgery? So yes, Dr. Maya is very right. So we have the ventriculoperitoneal shunt. Okay, that is the most important surgical management. Okay, if I talk about the medical management, we have acetazolamide, dimox, glycerol, and all those things. Okay. So Dr. Maya, a fabulous grandmom you have. Yeah, thank you so much, Dr. Maya. You have been very kind. Thank you so much. And you have helped me also in a lot of things in life. Thank you. Yeah, so the best surgical management of this condition is known as hydrocephalus. And the surgical management is ventriculoperitoneal shunt. Now, next slide, last 5-6 slides we have, we're going to cover it. So now this is the next set of questions. The question will come in direct form. The question will come that a newborn is having a congenital heart disease. If I'm saying it is a PDA, he is having nothing but a cataract and this newborn is having deafness. Okay. So what are the words, which syndrome does the newborn fit into? So congenital toxoplasmosis, congenital varicella syndrome, and congenital rubella syndrome. So very good, Dr. Sanya. Very good, Dr. Madhumita. So beautiful answer, congenital rubella syndrome. So the mnemonic is CAFE, coffee, day, CCD. Congenital heart disease, which is nothing but a pediatrosis, which is between the pulmonary artery and descending aorta. That is one more question, okay? It is not between the pulmonary artery and ascending aorta or arch of aorta. It is pulmonary artery and descending aorta, the patent ductus arteriosus. Okay, that's another question. So that's it. This question is CAFE coffee day is a case of congenital rubella syndrome. The triad is the congenital heart disease, which is nothing but the most common congenital heart is the patent ductus arteriosus. And then you have cataracts and then you have deafness. There was one more question that in CAFE coffee day, which is the most common manifestation. So deafness is the most commonest manifestation of rubella syndrome. We have covered 3 questions right now. Okay, number one, that triad of congenital rubellaic cafe coffee day. And the second question is most common congenital heart in congenital rubella syndrome. The answer is patent ductus arteriosus. And third is, which is the most common manifestation in cafe coffee day? The answer is deafness is the most common manifestation. Okay, very good. Okay, now next question. Very good, Dr. Mayank. Very good, beautiful. So what is this? Can anyone tell me what is this shape of the head? I'm not able to understand. Can anyone tell me what is it normal, this shape of the head, like a triangle? Is this normal? Can anyone tell me what do you call this? So very good, Dr. Tina is saying it's a craniosynostosis. So like craniosynostosis. So we have this skull and we have various sutures, right? We know that, right? So we have the wonderful Dr. Maya. She's a gold medalist from London. Dr. Maya, I know you're a gold medalist from London. So could you help us out? So Dr. Maya, which suture is this? This is with suture. This is with suture. What do you call this suture? And what do you call this suture? It's a revision class, okay? I'll not go in detail. Detail, you have to buy my app and watch the lectures, but I'm just telling you randomly now. So the sutures are, number one, we have nothing but metopic suture. Very good. And then we have this, very good, we have coronal suture. And then we have this sagittal suture. And then we have the lambdoid suture. Yes or no? Very good, very good. Lambdoid suture, very good. Okay, so which is so premature fusion of the metopic suture causes this problem, which is nothing but trigonocephaly. Trigonocephaly, very good, Dr. Maya, the gold medalist. So, perfect. So, premature fusion of the metopic suture will cause trigonocephaly, and premature fusion of the coronal suture will cause brachycephaly. Yes or no? Brachycephaly. Okay. So I'll repeat again. Premature fusion of the will cause trigonocephaly. Coronal suture will cause brachycephaly. And sagittal suture will cause dolichocephaly. Dolichocephaly, or also known as scaphocephaly. Scaphocephaly. That you should know. It's a revision class. So I'm just repeating. This image-based question shows trigonocephaly. So remember, if this year a trigonocephaly has come, the next year could be a scaphocephaly will come, or a dolichocephaly or plagiocephaly will come. Okay. Now coming to the next slide. Okay. This was the diagram over now. Yeah. This one. Yeah. So what do you call, what is the shape of this head? Can anyone help me out? Dr. Maya, what do you think? What is this baby showing the problem? Yeah, Dr. Maya is very right. So most importantly, we can see that, right? Very good, Dr. Mayan, Dr. Anjum Milia. So this is nothing but a very important, it's very important. It's a dolichocephaly. Dr. Anjum, it is a dolichocephaly. Can you see that? If I pause this video, then like you can see this baby is, you know, this one. So the AP diameter, we can see that the AP diameter is more than the transverse diameter. So I assume it could be a premature fusion of the sagittal suture known as dolichocephaly, or also known as scaphocephaly. So it's a fusion. Okay, typical PK. Okay, yeah, coming to again next image based question. Last five images we have, I'm gonna cover the whole session. What is this? If I say this, show you this picture, what syndrome comes to your mind? Okay, blue sclera, Dr. Sanya is saying. Okay, Dr. Mayank, what do you think, Dr. Shreya? Yeah, Dr. Shreya has one point. So this condition nothing but known as heterochroma iridis. Heterochroma iridis means change in the shade, in the color of the iris. Like my iris is black. Change in the color of the iris. So now if I tell you a patient having heterochroma iridis, a patient having mental retardation, which is now known as intellectual disability. And if I tell you this patient is having white forelock of hairs, okay, forelock is a tough English word, white bunch of hairs at the front. So which syndrome does that fit into? So Dr. Tina is very right, very good. Nothing but Waardenburg syndrome. Okay, very good. That's how the question will come, my dear friends. That's how the question comes in exam. Even though MBBS, MD, I recently gave my super speciality exam. They're also saying like this only indirectly they had asked the question. A newborn having heterochroma iridis, a mental retardation, hearing loss, and he's having a white bunch of hair. So Dr. Mayank, beautiful answer. Dr. Maya, very good. Proud of you. So Waardenburg syndrome. Imagine the hospital warden. So hostel warden like that, you may imagine he's coming to you. Okay, so what is this? Next, surgical pediatric surgery, very important, top two classes, top class image. So what do you call this? Any idea, Dr. Tina? So what is it that are out? So when the abdominal contents are out without any covering or a layer of the sac, so this is nothing but gastroschisis. Okay, very important, it's nothing but gastroschisis. These all are the recent AIMS questions, very important. I have took time to actually gather all the books and took the images, try to gather them and show you. So that is helpful for you. So there's nothing but very important. The abdominal contents are out. Yes, very good. So there's nothing but gastroschisis. Dr. Tina has come with a very beautiful answer. This one, Dr. Tina is telling about this. Very good, Dr. Tina. So most importantly, that this covering, very good, Dr. Tina has come with a very beautiful answer. If the abdominal contents are out with a covering, with a sac, with a peritoneum, with something, that is nothing but omphalocele. Yes or no? That is nothing but omphalocele. Okay, are you able to understand? Okay, gastroschisis, the abdominal contents will be out, but there will be no covering. That is the first point. Omphalocele, there will be a covering. Omphalocele usually have all the other contents also out, like liver, spleen, you know, other contents also will come out in a case of omphalocele, whereas gastroschisis, in general, you see the intestine coming out. These are the top class important points regarding the gastroschisis. So you saw a recent image-based question of gastroschisis. You saw recent image-based question of the omphalocele. Okay, you should never forget, midnight, 2 o'clock also, if I wake you up and tell you what is the condition, you should say, sir, I think it's a case of omphalocele. Sir, I think there's some sac. Sir, I think liver, kidney, or could be other contents also can come out in this condition. Okay, next. Same, it is nothing but a omphalocele that you should know. Okay, next one. Yeah, a beautiful question. Yeah, very good, Dr. Madhumita. Thank you so much. So, a beautiful recent AIMS question. Can anyone tell me what comes to your mind if I show you this picture? Okay, so Dr. Mahima has come with a beautiful answer known as Williams syndrome. Shreya has come with elfin faces. Beautiful, yes. So, yes, beautiful answer is nothing but, most importantly, is nothing but Williams syndrome. Okay, William syndrome. Okay, so William syndrome, most important. So William syndrome, the point number one, that's his eyes, this ears, can you see that? It's nothing but elfin faces. In German mythology, it's one supernatural being is there, supernatural god or something is there, which they, you know, they praise and they worship. So that is like elf, okay? Like, so that shape of the head and the face looks like this, known as elfin face, but a case of William syndrome. And the most common congenital heart in William syndrome is, even again, my grandmother also knows this answer. So the most common congenital heart in William syndrome is, Dr. Maya, anyone? I'll not tell you. Who will tell me? Which is the most common congenital heart in William syndrome? I will not tell you if you will not tell me. Yeah. Sorry, my pen is not yet for me. The most commonest congenital heart and Williams syndrome is supravalvular aortic stenosis. It was last to last year NEET PG question. And this year, again, the Williams syndrome question had come. Okay, that you should know. That's it. It's a case of Williams syndrome. Supravalvular aortic stenosis, the most common congenital heart. Elfin faces, the supernatural being and all that. Done. Okay, what is it, Dr. Maya? What do you think? Class 4 baby also can tell this answer. Can anyone tell me what is this? What is this? So, nothing but hair on end appearance. Okay, hair on end appearance, or also known as anyone, crew cut appearance. Yes or no? So, where do you see hair on end appearance? Very good, Dr. Maya. Very good, Dr. Sanya. So, thalassemia. Okay, thalassemia. Very good. So thalassemia, very important. So in this extramedullary hematopoiesis and all that, so you see a hair on end appearance or a crew cut appearance. Okay. So hair on end appearance or a crew cut appearance, you see a case of thalassemia, and you see microcytic hypochromic picture in this case. Next one. Yeah. Again, this was my last week, quiz question. Okay. In this one. Anyone who is not part of my WhatsApp group can, you know, WhatsApp me on 9999987081. This is our WhatsApp group of the statewide pediatrics one-line revision classes, you can join our group of this one, pediatrics by Dr. Anand. So what is this? It's nothing but a cornflakes pod. These grains, like white grains with little erythematous base is there. So pathognomonic of measles, nothing but cornflakes spot. Again, a recent need question. Identify the image shown in the picture. The answer is the case of cornflakes spot. It is seen in measles. Fever with rash on day four. Okay, fever with rash on day four is measles. Okay, day four. Okay, Dr. Akin is day four. Okay, day one is varicella and day two is scarlet fever. Day three is smallpox. Day four is measles. Day five is the typhus. Day six is dengue and day seven is typhoid. Okay, done. Next. What is this? Again, as we said, kindly mute your mic. Thank you so much. Last 2 minutes left. We want to finish it up. What is it? Again, a recent question, a recent important question. Can anyone tell me? This was the straightaway NEET PG question. This image was very important. It had come. It might have come. I don't know. So this one. So what do you call this? What syndrome is this? So Potter, okay. Anyone else? What? Can you see the sacral agenesis? Can you see that the sacrum, the down part is not there? Kindly mute your mic. Thank you so much. Whose mic is on? So kindly mute your mic. Otherwise, I have to mute all. Okay, good. So I have done mute all. Perfect. So yeah. So very important. It's a case of sirenomelia. Okay, it's a case of sirenomelia. It's nothing but a caudal regression syndrome in general. So caudal regression. Yeah, Shweta has already told the answer which I'm going to ask. So infant of diaphytic mother. You know, the most common neurological abnormality in infant of diaphytic mother is a neural tube defect, and the most specific is the caudal regression syndrome. This case is a case of sirenomelia or nothing but a caudal regression syndrome, and maternal diabetes has to be connected to that. I'll show you an awesome picture of this one. So what is this? Can anyone tell me? I'm soon going to make a YouTube video on this. So what is this picture? What do you call this? Any idea? What is this? Can you see that? Any idea? So very important. So again, same. It's not phocomelia, but it's a fusion. Can you see it's a fusion? Can you see that? It's like a fusion of the lower limbs. So the same only. See, like, yeah, very good. Mermaid in the pictures, it is a case of mermaid syndrome. It's a fusion of the lower extremities is there. Okay, that you should know. Okay, yeah, very nice. Yeah, this one. Again, a recent aim question. Fast. Rash over the neck plus history of child on maize diet. Rash over the neck and history of child on maize diet. So what is this? Yeah. So who's that? Madhumita, Hina and Shweta. Very good. So nothing but Dr. Maya is not there. I think she has gone somewhere. So nothing but very important. Kessel's neck. That's an indirect question. Why maize? Why maize is connected? Because maize has no niacin. So the child who was on maize diet, they are saying the normally maize diet is deficient in niacin, and niacin deficiency can lead to pellagra. Okay, and you know that diarrhea, dementia, dermatitis, and death. The 4 D's of pellagra is diarrhea, dementia, dermatitis, and death. That is vitamin B3 deficiency. B3 is niacin. Yeah, vitamin B3 deficiency, and that's it. Finish. Next. Again, a recent question. Can anyone tell me what is this? What is this? Anyone tell me what is this? Goal, goal, goal. Coil, coil, coil. What is this? Any idea? Where do you see coil spring sign? Anyone? Anyone has given a recent AIMS paper? He should know the answer. So coiled spring sign. Coiled. Dr. Maya, anyone? Coiled spring sign. So where do you see coiled spring sign? So coiled. Very good, Dr. Akin. Coiled. Very good, Dr. Shweta. Coiled spring sign is nothing but just seen in intestinal suction. Okay, coiled spring sign suction. So what is the triad of intestinal suction? Any idea? What is the triad? What is the triad of intestinal suction? I don't remember. Can anyone tell me what is the triad of intestinal suction? Who will tell me? Any idea? Any random guesses? Who will tell me the triad of intestinal suction? So the triad of intestinal suction. Anyone? Pain abdomen, palpable mass. Very good. So we have pain abdomen, palpable mass, PPR. Remember P. P and R. I'll not write pain abdomen, palpable mass. Dr. Maya has come again. Red current jelly stools. Okay. Pain abdomen, palpable. You have to link and study. You have to make mnemonics and study. Then only some syllabus will over. If you are imagining the whole book will be over, it's not possible. So pain abdomen, palpable mass, and red current jelly stools are the triad of intersubstantial. Next. Yeah. What is this? A recent milestone. What is this milestone? Any idea? So what do you call this? Any idea? What is this milestone, Shreya, Dr. Maya? What do you think? What is this milestone? More than Handegard, yes, Dr. Tina is right. Bidextrous approach, very good. So it's nothing but bidextrous approach. Decent need PG question. So monodextrous approach, bidextrous approach and unidextrous approach. So any idea when does it come? So 4 and 6. So we have 4 months you have bidextrous approach and 6 months you have unidextrous approach. Unidextrous. Okay. Bidextrous means holding something with both the hands. Comes at 4 months. Unidextrous means holding something with one hand. Comes at 6 months. Image-based question, Dr. Maya. Very good. Very right. Okay. What is the picture showing? Fast. Last slide of the day. What is this picture showing? What is this? What is this color? I don't know. What do you call this? What do you call this? Any idea? Madhumita again has topper. Very good. Very answer. So, Shakir tape. Okay. Very good. So, very beautiful answer. Dr. Maya, Dr. Digvijay. So, nothing but a Shakir tape. I think it is less than 11. Mid upper arm circumference looks like less than 11.5 centimeter because it is showing red color. Yes or no? So it's a case of severe acute malnutrition. Severe acute malnutrition that you should know. Okay, Ayush Bindra, one doubt. Go, you can ask me on the WhatsApp group. I'm so sorry because you have to wind up. I have one more USMLE class at 9:30. Okay, so that's it. So mid upper arm circumference less than 11.5 centimeter. It's a WHO classification of severe acute malnutrition. The picture showing Shakir tape, image-based question that you should know. Okay, it's an acute epiglottis. This is how the epiglottis look like. Just wanted to show you because when you intubate, you have to see the epiglottis. Then only you can intubate. And in a case of what is this? It's an acute epiglottitis. Images, the red swollen epiglottis. Acute epiglottitis, okay. So red, cherry red, red swollen epiglottis. You give ceftriaxone, third generation cephalosporin. Perfect. Last question. What is this? What do you call it? What is the picture and this one? So what is this? Yeah, very good. So this one is nothing but a vaccine vial monitor. Vaccine vial monitor. So can this be used? Is it good to use or bad to use? If you see this picture, is it good to use? Yeah, very good. Very good. Is it good to use? You know that, right? If the inner sphere is whitish, right now in this picture, if the inner sphere is whitish and the outer is blue, it is good to use. But if the inner sphere matches the outer, now it is discarded. Vaccine has to be discarded, right? Okay, I'll repeat again for the newcomers. Yeah, so Maya is very right. So if the inner sphere is whitish as compared to the outer circle, it is good to use. If the inner square matches the outer circle, it is discarded. You should discard it. And if the inner square is little darker than the outer, it is beyond discard point. Okay, that you should know. Okay, what is this instrument shown as? Any from Maya? Even my grandmother can tell you the answer. Dr. Maya can tell or not. It's a bag and mask ventilation. Bag and mask ventilation. Need PG question number one. It's a Ambu bag. This is a pop-up valve. Here we have the fish mouth valve. This is how we make the seal by using a CE clamp technique and all that. So that's a bag and mask ventilation. And Dr. Tina has right. The most commonest, the contraindication of bag and mask ventilation is congenital diaphragmatic hernia, where you see a scaphoid-shaped abdomen, bowel sound in the chest. Left side, it is more common, and Bock-Delac hernia, which is known as. The question, this one. So what do you, okay, I'll not play the video. If you want, I'll play the video. This is nothing but, again, I'm showing the question is the baby in distress? And which scoring system you will use for this baby? So number one, is the baby is in distress? Yes, sir. If I give you a 1 minute video, you can see the RR of the baby is more than. So when do you call distress? Any idea? Dr. Maya, what is the normal RR of a newborn? Any idea? What is the normal RR of a newborn? The normal respiratory rate of a newborn is 40 to 60 cycles per minute. Anyone with more than 60 cycles per minute, I will say this child is having fast breathing. That this child is having fast breathing. Okay. And we have the WHO cutoff of fast breathing for till 2 months of life, 0 to 2 months of life. If more than 60 cycles per minute is the normal respiratory rate, I will say this child is having fast breathing. Okay. Then we have 3 months to 1 year, 1 year to 5 year, like more than 50, more than 40. okay, respiratory rate. It is a rapid revision class, so I'm not telling you in detail. In detail, you have to open the app, you have to watch the videos nicely. Okay, so number one, this case, yes, the baby is having distress. And number two, if this baby is preterm, sir, I think we will use Silverman Anderson score, and that's it. Okay, cutoff of the heart rate. The normal heart rate of a newborn, OP Guy and Nelson, 120 to 140 beats per minute, and some books is 120 to 160 beats per minute also. OP Guy also have written same thing, only 120 to 160, 120 to 140. That's what the both books have written, the normal heart rate of a newborn. But severe bradycardia is nothing but less than 60 beats per minute. Severe bradycardia is less than 60. Okay. Age-wise, my dear, I have no idea. It is not there. Okay. So next, what is this? Any idea? What do you call this? Anyone can even help me out? What is this? A beautiful picture. What do you call this condition? What is this? Any idea? It's nothing but anyone. Dr. Maya, what do you think? Anyone is nothing but, I'll not tell you, H is nothing but hymenal tank. Okay, hymenal tank. Okay, very good. One of the conditions in newborn which looked abnormal but is normal. A recent TGI question also, that a newborn female child having a hymenal tank, mother got worried, took the baby to NICU. Now what the pediatrician should do? Rule out congenital hypothyroidism, rule out inborn error of metabolism, and rule out shock. Or fourth is conservative, nothing to do. So the answer is conservative management. So Dr. Maya, beautiful answer. Next. Okay, last question. What is this syndrome looks like? If I give you a hint, a baby is having hypoplasia of the lower limbs. Hypoplasia of the lower limbs. This child is having. See, that's how your mind should work. Okay, I'll show you images. Tell me the answer. I'll show you the images. Tell me the answer. That's it. No more than that. So, a child having hypoplasia of the lower limbs with cicatrical skin lesions. Number one, hypoplasia of the lower limbs. Number two, cicatrical skin lesions. Number three, if I give you a history, that mother is having history of fever with rash. Mother having history of fever with rash in the first and second trimester. So all these points are nothing but congenital varicella syndrome. Congenital varicella syndrome is the best answer. Dr. Madhumita, very good. Dr. Medico underscore 1297, beautiful. And Shreya, yes. So it's a case of congenital varicella syndrome. The triad is cicatrical skin lesion over the face and body, hypoplasia of the lower limbs, and mother having history of fever with rash in the first and second trimester. And what do you give? Varicella zoster immunoglobulin in the vaccine. That's next. What do you call this? What is this? Any idea? Can anyone help me out? What is this? What is this condition? A recent question where the head is diffused. Let's okay. No minute. So what do you call this? Very good, Dr. Madhumita. Very nice. Nothing but craniopagus. Okay, craniopagus. Very good. So we have thoracopagus where the thorax is attached. We have craniopagus where the craniums are attached. So surgical management. So craniopagus is nothing but craniopagus. Craniopagus. Okay. Yeah, this part is over. Which vaccine is this? Dr. Maya, can you tell me which vaccine is this? And if you can't read, if you are watching in mobile, I'll read for you. It is written store in minus 20 degrees Celsius. It is saying store in minus 20 degrees Celsius. So what is the answer? So the answer is oral polio vaccine. Okay. Yeah, oral polio vaccine. Okay, that you should know. Okay. And what do you call it? Okay, we have Swati. She's asking TB and HIV quiz this Sunday, sir. What are the sources? So OP Guy is good, and recent guidelines. This revised National Tuberculosis Program guidelines 2019. You read them. Few questions are made from them also. If anyone doesn't know, we have a WhatsApp group on 9999897081 statewide. So for the pediatric revisions, one-liners, all the case discussions, it will be helpful for you. Just message your name and that you have attended this session. I will provide you the link. So all the vaccines are stored under 2 to 8 degrees Celsius except the OPV, except the OPV, which is stored under minus 20 degrees Celsius. Okay, that you should know. Fine, that's it. So your future depends on what you do today. I'll repeat again. Your future depends on what you do today. And your today has already started. Okay, listen carefully. Your future depends on what you do today. And your today has already started. So So start studying today only. Don't wait for tomorrow. Don't wait for day after tomorrow. Okay. Give your best and all the best. Thank you so much for your participation. That was all about pediatrics for Dr. Anand. I hope you loved it, liked it, and be happy. That's it. Okay. Bye, Dr. Swati. Bye, Shashank. Bye, Dr. Maya. Bye, Dr. Kaur. Thank you. Very sweet of you.
Great session, Anand. All the best. Thank you. Wonderful it was. Thank you very much. Bye.
Thank you, sir.